chapter is dealing with new converts. But I want to read a few verses here in the beginning of it to try to share with you where I'm coming from so you will kind of get the idea as well as to what is expected from believers. And might I say, this is not just for new converts, but this is for all believers. As we look at 1 Peter chapter number 2. Verse number 1 says, "Wherefore laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings." Verse number 2 is really where we get the idea of my thought. "As newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious." And I'll stop my reading there for the sake of time. But there are a lot of things that a newborn or a believer has to learn once they are saved. And I use that word saved very lightly, because some people can say, or anybody can say, they are saved, but it takes someone different. And I think the meaning goes deeper when you say born again. That carries a whole lot more weight. Or a believer, I use that phrase very, very lightly. I like to say when somebody makes a profession that they were born again, because that's actually what takes place in the life of a person when they make a profession. They are a newborn and they are born again into the family of God. And just like a baby has to be taught a lot of things as a newborn, so a believer has to be taught. Jesus even said in the Great Commission that we are to go into all nations and preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And then he says, teaching them whatsoever I have commanded you. Amen. And then he said, "And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." So he says that we have a mandate and a responsibility to teach new converts responsibilities and things that they need to learn. Peter shares with us several things in this chapter that new converts, once you get saved, now what? Well, they need to learn some things about sin. If you'll notice in verse number 1, Paul or Peter makes this plain. He says, "Wherefore laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speaking." So when he said laying aside, that puts it upon the responsibility of the believer to do away with some things in their life. Now, these things that he mentions here, they are sins. I'll just go ahead and define them for you, because a lot of times we don't understand what these mean, and I have a good dictionary at home that helps me understand them, and I predetermined and looked and got them all wrote down. That's why I know. But anyway, that word malice in that verse, it gives reference to wickedness or depravity of mind. And wickedness is one thing that a newborn believer, and by the way, it's not just for newborns. We as older Christians, we struggle with the same thing. Amen. That we also need to lay aside wickedness. Matter of fact, Paul took it a step further when he said that we are to abstain from the very presence of evil. Yeah. And so wickedness, that can carry a wide variety of things. It could be wicked thinking, a wicked habit, or a wicked mindset, or wicked actions, or different things. But it is up to us and our responsibility to learn about laying these things aside. And all guile and hypocrisies. And guile is given reference to being mischievous or playing trickery or games or being sneaky or for self-gain. To do things in a people are good at playing spiritual games, and they do things in order for self-advantage, in order to promote themselves. In other words, they're not being honest in their heart. They're being kind of backwards. And when a person gets saved, we ought to lay away the malice and the guile. And we ought to be open and honest in our own life, not playing spiritual games. And then he says, and all hypocrisies. And we know what hypocrisy is. Hypocrisy is to appear one way and to be another. It is to change faces. In other words, to be one person one day and another person another day. Some people say, well, that's me. I'm bipolar. I'm one way, and I'm another way the next day. And, you know, no. It means to be the same wherever you are, to put away all hypocrisies. That means don't try to appear to be something that you're not. Don't be a hypocrite. Don't play the spiritual game of changing faces. And Peter was saying, lay that aside. Be real. Be genuine. Be who you are. Be a believer. And don't put on a show and try to be a fake. Yeah. And it's hard sometimes to lay aside. He says, then not only hypocrisies, but envies. What are envies? Envy is nothing more than jealousy. If envy could speak, here's what envy would say. Envy would say this: I like what you got. I don't like the fact that you've got it, and I want it.
True.
That's what envy would say.
True.
And envy and jealousy are twin brothers or twin sisters, either one. If they had a gender, I don't know which one they would be. But I'll say that again. If envy could speak, it would say this: I like what you got. I don't like the fact that you got it, and I want it. And so that is a sin to have a covetous heart and to be jealous of someone else. And Peter is saying, lay it aside. It's your responsibility. You see, there's some things that God does for us. And thank God that He saves our soul. Amen. He forgives our sin. He's applied the blood on the mercy seat on your behalf and on mine. He does all these things. But then He leaves and we're saved. Now we need to go to work on ourselves. And can I say this? It's not just newborns that need to go to work on themselves. Some of us older Christians need to go to work on ourselves.
Amen.
Some of us need to put away some malice.
Right.
Some of us need to put away some guile. And some of us need to put away envy. And some of us need to put away some hypocrisy.
Right.
Sure. And then he says this. And then he says, and evil and all evil speaking. That means, too, when you speak evil, that means you're talking about somebody. That's gossip. And so he said, you know, let me tell you what the hardest thing to do is control that flapper. That tongue right here gets us in more trouble than anything else. Has anybody ever in here had your tongue get you in trouble?
Yes.
How many of us has ever said anything and you went to God and you'd never say it? Be honest.
Yes.
How many of you feel like there's been times you need to lay your tongue on the altar?
Amen, brother.
How many of y'all know somebody that the altar ain't big enough for them to lay their tongue on? I fit into that category a time or two myself.
Amen, brother.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
And so he said, now, look, I know you say you're a newborn babe in the Lord. And isn't this something? He's defining these actions as someone that's a newborn, kind of giving us the idea that those that's been saved a while shouldn't have to do this.
Yes. Yes.
Does that kind of tell us that we might be, if we're dealing with some of these things, we still might be a baby?
Yeah.
Man. Oh, Lord, we're talking about baby stuff now, and isn't it amazing that some of us are still struggling? And by the way, the amount of years that you've been saved or I've been saved does not define the stage of maturity that you are as a believer.
Amen. Amen.
You could have been saved 30 years and still be a baby. And yet you can be saved 10 years and already be mature.
Yes.
And he said, lay aside all these evil speakings. And he said, it's up to you as to whether or not. So he says, I'm trying to teach you something about sin.
And that's one of the things we've got to learn, not just as a newborn, but as a believer that's growing in the Lord, we need to lay some of these aside, these sins. Now, then he says something about the Scripture. Notice in verse number 2. He says, as newborn babes, here's, notice, pay close attention to this next word, desire.
Yeah.
Desire the sincere milk of the Word, that ye may grow thereby. Let me tell you why I believe sometimes people don't ever reach the stage of maturity. They never get the Word in them. I had a conversation with Brent this afternoon about this. He came to the house for a while. We was fellowshipping, and I was trying to tell Brent, you made a profession of faith. I believe you got saved. Now get in the Word and let the Word get in you. Amen. It's kind of like this. A lot of times people will go to church and you hear the Word and it gets on you, but it ain't going to be no good until it gets in.
Right.
The idea of a baby. I know we have some babies in our church. I don't think we've got any here tonight. Could you imagine if that baby, if they got hungry and they're a newborn, if you just throw milk all over them? Is that going to help them? No.
That's good.
You get the bottle, you put milk in it,
right,
and you force feed them in there.
Right. That's
good. Huh? And that milk gets in them.
Yes.
Yes.
And it's amazing. Some preachers, we have to spend our life trying to force feed some. They don't. But you make them drink the milk, do you not? And you teach them how to drink that milk. Now, to desire the Word. And I want to say this. This is not only good for new believers, but older ones as well.
Amen.
God created in us a desire and a hunger for the Word of God to get in. Not just hearers, James even said, be not just hearers only, but doers. And how are you going to be a doer if it don't get in you?
Right.
So like this, when I go to do sin, or if I have a sinful thought, or want to give in and indulge in the flesh, well, then verses are going to start coming to me like, and red flags, broken mark, it's going to start coming to me. Like if I go to get mad automatically, Ephesians 4:29, be angry and sin not. I love that verse. Because I can use that verse as justify being mad. He said, be angry. All right. Ain't got no problem with that. I can be angry. What about y'all?
Amen.
Here's the hard part. Sin not.
Yeah. That's right.
That's the tough part. He said, be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. That means I got a whole day, friend. Till the sun goes down. Really, we'll wait till the last minute to get it right to begin with, won't we?
Yes, we will.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we will. And so we get that Word in us. Now, how do we get the Word in us? How do we do it? Y'all don't look at me like I'm crazy. Is the preacher's job to force feed you? No. If the only time you're getting fed is when you come to church, you're going to starve to death.
Amen.
You better get you some milk. And by the way, the only way you're ever going to be able to have any deep doctrinal truths is the Word, is get to where you grow to the place of maturity where you can understand and enjoy the meat. But until then, you got to get in here yourself and get it in you.
Amen.
You got to get it in you. Comes through daily devotions and Bible time. Spending time around the house. Get you a good dictionary and a concordance out. Make time. You say, well, I just don't have time. You want to hear God speak to you? Other than in church? Get in the book. This is God's Word. If you want to know what God's got to say, get in it. He'll speak to you through His Word. And as a newborn, you say, now, get in the Word. Ingest it. Desire it. Crave it. Learn it. It'll help you and it'll bring you to the stage of maturity. That Word is one of the most important part of everything. By the way, how are you going to fight the devil if you don't know how to use your sword?
Right.
That's good, brother.
Huh? Once you get saved, stand, having our loins girt about with truth, our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, having on the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, having the shield of faith that you're able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And then he says, have the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. God, give us one offensive weapon, and that is your King James Bible.
Amen.
You need to learn it. You need to learn how to use it. Get it in you. Get it on you. Carry it with you everywhere you go.
Yeah.
That's not just good for a new convert. That's good for anybody that's in the army of God.
Learn your Bible. Get acquainted with your Bible. Learn these old stories. Get acquainted with Noah and Moses and Daniel and the lion's den. God's got to create that craving. I remember right after I got saved, man, you couldn't. I'd have my Bible with me. I remember I'd do a little buildings with Daddy. I'd carry my Bible, have my Bible up on the dash. Some people said, well, you was a preacher. No, I wasn't then. No, I wasn't. I was just a newborn convert. Man, I couldn't get enough of this word.
Amen.
I wanted to listen to preaching every time I could.
Amen.
I'd want to read books, and I still don't like reading, but something happened on the inside of me that I couldn't get enough of the Word. I want it, and I'm still that way. There's nothing I love anymore than to hear a preacher anointed by God take this Word right here and prepare a spread and a table and sit up there and feed me the Word of God.
Yeah.
I'm not interested so much in his jokes or his performance or his antics or anything like that. All that just makes it a little funny from time to time. But when a man of God gets up, opens up this Word, I know the Word ain't going to come back void, and this Word is going to be a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And if I'll have this Word in my heart, I might not sin against God. You need to get in the book, and God, thank God for me. Then he gives us something about not only the scripture, but he also tells us that they need to learn something about sacrifices. Look at verse number 5. Ye also as lively stones. Now he's telling them who they are. Build up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood. Watch this. To offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Now, what are some of the sacrifices that we offer up? One of them is ourselves. Paul said in Romans chapter 12, verse number 1, he said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service.
Yep.
Then he says, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. And going on and on. But we are to offer up our body, ourselves, as a sacrifice. In other words, we say, God, here I am. Here's my body. What does that mean? That means I'm giving God my body. Whatever it is. Teenagers, give God your body. Then you won't have to worry about your period. Husbands and wives, we give God our body and say, God, I'm yours. Here I am. Take me. When you give God your whole life, your whole body, then He's in control and you're submitting your authority, your life into the hands of Him. Another thing that we sacrifice or we offer up as a sacrifice is our praise. Hebrews chapter 13, verse number 17 says this, by Him, therefore, let us offer up the sacrifice of praise, which is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks unto His
Amen.
Name.
Amen.
So that's a sacrifice. So that means once you get saved, you ought to praise His name.
Amen.
That's a sacrifice. Well, Brother Dougie, when you go to praise Him, clapping your hands, that's a sacrifice. Brother Joe, when you get excited and start saying, that's a sacrifice. Daddy, when your sugar gets up and you get happy, that's a sacrifice. You know what I mean? We're way behind on offering up sacrifice.
Amen.
Hey, we're way behind. That's a sacrifice. We offer it up.
Amen.
Some people say, well, I sacrifice my time. That's good. Some say I sacrifice my money. Well, the only way you're sacrificing any money at all is if you give above your tithe. If you don't ever give above your tithe, you're just giving God what's His. You never offered up a sacrifice if you don't give an offering.
That's right.
Some people say, well, I gave God $40 this week. Well, was that your tithe or did you put an offering in there? There's no sacrifice in it if you didn't put an offering. And so once a person is saved, we learn about sacrifices. And there's a lot
lot of things. And by the way, we don't sacrifice much.
No.
We're getting a whole lot more than we give up.
Amen, brother.
I promise you that. But teaching a new convert that, hey, you need to sacrifice your Sunday and give that Sunday to God. Can I get an amen?
Amen. Amen.
Sacrifice your time and be at church.
Yeah.
Oh, it's quiet now.
Right.
You say, preacher, you're getting ready to go on vacation. Yeah, but I'm going to church. Promise you that. Sacrifices. Sometimes it's hard to learn this. Then he says he teaches us something not only about sacrifices, but then he teaches us something about the sanctuary. Look at verse number 6. It says, wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion, which is Zion, a picture, there was Zion in Jerusalem, a picture of the place of worship, a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you therefore which believe he is precious, who's he talking about? Who's he talking about? Who's precious? Huh? No. Jesus. Unto you that believe he is precious. That's Jesus. We as the people of God, we believe Jesus is precious. Watch this now. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner. Now who's he talking about? It's the chief cornerstone.
Jesus.
Right?
Jesus.
Who's the head of the cornerstone? Jesus. Jesus cornerstone. Does anybody know what a corner is to a building? Right here is a corner. Ah! I heard that. The corner is where it keeps the building together. Am I right?
Right.
The corner is one of the strongest points. You take the corner out, and this wall gets very, very weak. Am I right?
Amen.
It don't take much to blow down a wall that don't have a corner. You remove this corner, and the wall is going to fall. Now, what he's saying is this. The only way the church is staying together is because Jesus is the cornerstone keeping it together. Go a step further. Let me take a step further. A lot of people think that when they become a part of the church, they are the ones that keep the church together. And their family is the only reason the church is together. And without their family, the church will fall. Let me go ahead and say this. Thank God for all the families that are faithful to the house of God. But I want to say this. The church is not resting upon you or your family to stay faithful in order for the church to stay strong. And we need to teach new converts. And it'd be good for some of us older believers to remember that the head of the church and the reason the church is staying strong and the building ain't failed is because the cornerstone is still holding on.
Amen.
And the church is sticking together.
Amen.
Exactly right. So whether a new convert needs to understand that it's not families that are keeping the church together. No, Jesus is the chief. And he's not only the chief, he's the chief cornerstone.
Yes.
Amen.
That means he's the reason the building ain't fell in.
Right.
That's right. He ain't never going to fall, he ain't never going to crumble. So they learn some things about sanctuary. But then they need to learn some things about separation. Look at verse number 11. Say, now what? Here's what it is. Separation. Dearly beloved, I beseech you, as strangers and pilgrims, watch, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. So he said, all right, now that you're saved, you need to separate yourself and don't create an opportunity like I was talking about this morning to cause yourself to enter and have to engage in a battle when it's already going to be hard enough as it is. If you know it's going to cause you to war, stay away from it. That word abstain means don't go there. If you've got a problem or something is going to tempt your flesh, don't do it. It says abstain from fleshly lust that war against the soul. Temptation is strong and real. I dealt with that right smart this morning. And we all have that desire. But there's sometimes I have to just say, no, I ain't going to do it. And teaching yourself and having the strength to turn and say, no, I'm not going to put myself in the position because my flesh is weak and I don't want to get into a spiritual battle and have to war internally. So there's some things they have to learn about separation. Separating themselves from certain things that's going to entice the flesh. Let me give you another one. What about, not only they need to learn about separation, but there's some things to learn about submission. Look at verse 13. Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to kings as supreme or to governors, as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. You know what he's talking about? Local government. Oh, preacher.
Yep.
Oh, you done talking about local government? Yep. By the way, I ain't against the popo.
Right. Amen.
Right.
Amen.
I'm for local authority.
Amen.
If there was no police or local authority, that's what he's doing. Submit to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake. In other words, he's talking about the ordinances of man. That's the laws of man on this earth.
Right.
Submit yourself to it. That means the speed limit says 55, try not to go over 65 to get there.
Yeah.
Now, if you go 66, they're probably going to write you a ticket and you're going to pay a big fine. Most of them say, no, what I'm talking about is living according to the law. Now, the ordinances of man, we could go a step further. There are ordinances of the Bible that we are to submit to once a person gets saved. One of those ordinances is water baptism. That is an ordinance that the New Testament church observes because it's Bible. The Bible even tells in the Great Commission that we are to baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. That way they are showing outwardly that they ain't ashamed of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Anybody that's ashamed to be recognized with Jesus, I doubt they really got the goods anyway.
Amen.
Why in the world would you want to be ashamed of somebody that saved your soul, forgave your sin, wrote your name down in the Lamb's Book of Life, sealed you to the day of redemption? He's coming again for you one day. Why would you be ashamed to be called a Christian?
Amen.
And so you follow through with these ordinances. Another ordinance we observe is the Lord's Supper. And we partake in that once you're a believer. Now, I know there's times where I tell you, parents, you have kids, we're to teach them what those ordinances mean. And that they're to follow those ordinances according to the Bible. And it takes a humble attitude and learning submission to submit ourselves.
Amen.
When you submit, and when we submit ourselves, that means that we are fallen in rank. Now, we use this word a lot along with the word submit, and that is surrender. But they have two totally different meanings.
Yeah.
And I believe the reason he used the word submit instead of surrender is because it carries a whole lot more weight.
Yeah.
The word surrender means to be taken by force against your will. That means I don't really want to,
yeah,
but you got me in a corner, so I give up.
You
wave the right flag. There's no way I can win, so I surrender. But when you submit, that is a willingness on your part that you don't have to, but you do anyway.
Amen.
Because you know it's the right thing.
Amen.
And it takes a lot to do that, to submit. It's a different. Don't say I'm surrendering. That means you don't really want to do it. Does this make sense to you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't say I'm surrendering. No, I'm submitting. That means I know my position, and I am submitting my life to the authorities that are above me, and I am going to follow in line. And if there's one area that we all struggle with from time to time, it is authority figures that God has placed in our life.
Amen.
Right.
Children struggle with authority. One of the worst words kids hate to hear is no. And it drives them crazy. And sometimes they'll go even crazier if you tell them no. But authority in our life, God places it there so that we won't get out of bounds.
Amen.
And it keeps us in line. While I'm on it, I'm going to go ahead and hit something else. Is that all right?
Amen.
This is going to help us better understand. You play baseball, there's authority. Authority figures. Called umpires. Right?
Right.
You play football, there's authority figures on the field. They're called referees, not umpires. For all y'all that don't watch football, and you say, what did that umpire make that call for? It ain't baseball. They don't make football bats, all right? There's never been such a thing. Of course, these liberals today are liable to come up with one. I'm waiting for them to change the pigskin footballs made out of to something else to satisfy the Muslims that play football. That would be something, have a Muslim football field. Hey, get this pass! He don't even know it's a pig skin. He's condemned right there. He's done. Called him such a pig. But anyway. Watch. Watch what I'm telling you now. Talking about having authority. When you got an authority in your life, that means you got to play by the rules. Y'all hang in there with me. I'm getting ready to take you something. When you got authority in your life, that means you play by the rules. That's what a lot of us, we don't like playing by the rules. God gives rules. What if there was no boundaries in baseball? What if you could run up in the stands? What if when you hit the ball, if it went up into the crowd behind home plate, it didn't matter. You could keep on running.
Right.
You'd be saying, that ain't fair now. That ain't fair. What if the football field? What if you could kick it up into the grandstands and take off? You know, it counted. Somebody in the stands could run and make a touchdown. What if playing basketball, there was no refs and you could play basketball up in the stands? Are y'all getting where I'm going with this?
That's right.
There has to be authority in our life to keep order.
Yeah.
If there's no authority, then there's no boundaries. And if there's no boundaries, we're in a mess. And a lot of times we kick against that authority. And imagine how crazy life would be without authority in our life.
Amen.
Y'all ain't getting what I'm saying.
Amen, brother.
Right.
Imagine how that would be. It would be absolutely crazy and pandemonium. That's why God has authority and is up to us as Christians. And one of the hardest things to learn is submission. And as a newborn believer, one of the most important things is that they learn to submit to the Spirit of God and the Word of God and allow Him to be in control of their life. Let me give you another one. I'm getting close to getting done, all right? Saved, now what? They got to learn some things about sin, about self, sacrifices, separation, sanctuary, submission, but they need to learn some things about the saints. Look at verse number 17. Honor all men. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the king. Servants, be subject to your masters. There's something else you learn. With all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. Boy, now ain't we learning something here? That means be good and gentle to those that ain't good and gentle back. Is that hard or what?
Yes.
So we need to learn something about loving the people of God. It says honor all men. Teaching new converts the responsibility. And by the way, when I got saved, I didn't have to be taught to love the brother. I fell in love with people I despised before I got saved. J.B. Shaver, I couldn't stand to see him because I knew one thing he was going to do as soon as I got ready. When you boys gonna get saved? I didn't want to see him. He embarrassed me everywhere I went. I remember one time at Jack's store, he was down there in my own community. He said, boy, your daddy's a preacher. It'd be bad if you'd die and go to hell. I mean, he was bold as a lion. You remember that? You remember him, Wayne? I thank God for it now. I couldn't stand him though before I got saved. But right after I got saved, guess who's one of the first people I wanted to go see? Boy, J.B. Shaver. Now I knew what he was talking about. I had a love for that man till the day he died. Yeah. I wanted to be everywhere and go everywhere with him. There's a love, and by the way, there's a love for the people of God that I've got now, that is, and you've got too. There's just a love for the brethren and the saints of God that you can't get nowhere else.
Amen.
Amen.
Right, preacher. You're right.
And by the way, the Bible says if you don't love the brother, how in the world do you know you even saved?
Yeah.
That's one of the ways you know you're in the family, is because you love the brother. Now, I didn't say I liked everybody. But I love them. My wife don't even like me sometimes. But she loves me. You hear that? That's right. But she loves me. And I know that. Something about sex. Then they learn something about being a servant, but then I need to learn about the Savior, and that is in verse number 22. Here's some things I don't ever need to forget. He did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who when he was reviled, he reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judges rightly, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. And here it is. For ye were, here's who we was. For ye were a sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and the bishop of your soul.
Amen.
Amen. Now, I'm going to make this little simple illustration and I'll be done. Somebody says, well, how in the world does God, our Father, know all of us so intimately? He does know us very intimately.
Yes, sir.
He does. Yes. He knows every one of us. As a matter of fact, He knows us so intimately. Brother Scott, even though you're losing some hair, He counted them this morning. He knows how many you got. Brother Irvin, He counted your hair. Miss Peggy, He counted yours. Miss Kim, He counted. Imagine. He knows the very hairs on our head. Now, somebody says, well, I don't know if how can you know for sure you're always going to be one of His? It's almost as if that once God takes you into His family, He'll put you up for adoption to where He don't know you no more. That's crazy. It's crazy. Let me share with you this. Think about this. If God knows all the hairs on your head, all of them, but let's go further. If God put a name on every star, and if He's numbered every star, don't ever think that He's going to have any trouble keeping up with all His children.
Amen.
Amen.
If you're here and if you just got saved like Brent, or if you've been saved a long time, He knows your name, and we are more important than all the stars in the sky.
Amen.
And if He is so intimate with the stars that He gave them a name, and He calls the stars My name, how much more is He intimate with you and I as the shepherd of our souls?
Yeah.
Amen.
Let's all stand our feet. I want Miss Sue to come on over here. Come on, the piano.